My dear Wormwood, so, your man is in love, in the worst kind he could possibly have fallen into, and with a girl who does not even appear in the report you sent me. I have looked up this girl's dossier, and am horrified at what I find. Not only a Christian, but such a Christian, a vile, sneaking, simpering, insignificant, virginal, bread-and-butter miss. The little brute, she makes me vomit. Why doesn't the enemy blast her for it, if he's so moonstruck by her virginity, instead of looking on there, grinning? Of course, he gets to know this woman's family and whole circle, a house full of impenetrable mystery. It bears a sickening resemblance to the description one human writer made of heaven, the regions where there's only one life, and therefore, all that is not music is silence. Music and silence, how I detest them both. How thankful we should be that ever since our father entered hell, no square inch of infernal space and no moment of infernal time has been surrendered to either of those abominable forces. Signed, Toadpipe, for his abysmal sublimity under Secretary Screwtape, T.E.B.S., etc. My dear Uncle Screwtape, I compose this letter in complete humility with regard to the client's current situation and his newfound interest. I decided to take the responsibility upon myself. My sincere apologies, dear uncle. I can assure you that nothing of this sort will happen again. Looking forward to your reply. Your grateful nephew, Wormwood. Through this girl and her disgusting family, the patient is now getting to know more Christians every day, and very intelligent Christians too. For a long time, it'll be quite impossible to remove spirituality from his life. Very well then, we must corrupt it. Looking around your patient's new friends, I find that the best point of attack would be the borderline between theology and politics. Several of his new friends are very much alive to the social implication of their religion. That in itself is a bad thing, but good can be made out of it. You'll find that a good many Christian political writers think that Christianity began going wrong, departing from the doctrine of his founders, at a very early stage. We thus distract men's minds from who he is and what he did. We first make him solely a teacher, and then conceal the very substantial agreement between his teachings and those of all other great moral teachers. Instead of the creator adored by his creature, we soon have merely a leader acclaimed by a partisan. The Gospels come later and were written not to make Christians, but to edify Christians already made. The historical Jesus, then, however dangerous he may seem to be to us at some particular point, is always to be encouraged. Certainly we do not want men to allow their Christianity to overflow into all their political life. The thing to do is to get a man at first to value social justice as a thing which the enemy demands. Only today I have found a passage in a Christian writer where he recommends his own version of Christianity on the ground that only such a faith can outlast the death of old cultures and the birth of new civilizations. You see the little rift? Believe this, not because it's true, but for some other reason. That's the game. Affectionate uncle, Screwtape.